Having dealt with the non-corporate sector, I now turn my attention to the corporate sector. The tax rates for this sector are not being changed. I am, however, providing one facility. Last year, while raising the surcharge payable by companies from 2.5% to 5%, I had given companies the option to make deposits of the additional surcharge with the Industrial Development Bank of India. I am now further providing that companies can henceforth exercise this option in respect of the entire amount of the surcharge payable by them. These resources will flow back to the corporate sector and will be available for modernization. In the earlier part of my speech, I have already referred to the decision to reduce the interest rates on loans up to rupees 2 crore being extended by IDBI under the soft loan scheme. Some relaxations are also being provided to those engaged in the business of growing and manufacturing tea. The existing provisions provide exemption from tax only in respect of subsidy received for replantation or replacement of tea buses. I am extending this tax exemption to cover subsidy received for other approved schemes relating to rejuvenation and consolidation of areas. I hope this measure will further lend support to our scheme for increasing production of tea. My next proposal, I believe, will be welcomed by a large number of people. Investors presently can receive dividends on interest on debentures without exemption certificate from the income tax officer, or alternatively file a declaration to the effect that their income for the year is below the exemption limit. To reduce paperwork and avoid inconvenience to small investors, I propose to provide that widely held companies may henceforth pay interest on debentures and dividend income up to rupees 1,000 without deduction of tax at source, provided that the payment is made by an account paying check or bank draft. Mr. Speaker, sir, I noticed that certain provisions of tax laws are being disused by a section of the tax bill. I had occasion last year to deal at some length with the taxation of charitable and religious trusts and institutions. I find that some of these trusts and institutions are trying to circumvent the investment pattern for trust funds laid down by the Finance Act 1983. It is necessary to ensure that all such trusts and institutions strictly conform to the prescribed investment pattern. I therefore propose to provide for fixation of income of defaulting trusts and institutions at the maximum marginal rate of income tax. Sir, the scope of this particular bill is very restricted, and there is no intention of expanding that scope so far as this amendment is concerned. But since the whole film industry is an important one, and as I see from the number of amendments tabled that honorable members are also taking a keen interest in the matter, I am alive to the situation and a thorough inquiry is going to be made into the film industry from all points of view. It is then that this house may go into the different aspects of the question as regards the length of time that a film should be shown, the length of the film and a number of other considerations which may come in. As I glance at the amendments tabled here, I see that a number of amendments are of that nature. It is natural that these amendments are placed before the House. But I beg to submit that since the object of this particular amendment is very restricted and one pointed, it is better that we concentrate upon this one single aspect, postponing the consideration of other aspects to the occasion when a more comprehensive bill is to be introduced in this House. We shall have ample opportunity at that time to go into the whole matter when the inquiry committee makes its own recommendations on different aspects and a suitable bill is framed in terms of those recommendations. Therefore, I should like to request honorable members to see that we restrict ourselves to consider this one angle important aspect and leave the matter there. Now, the main considerations which weigh with us at that time we see a film are these. Some people would say that it is a bad and unsuitable film. If these schemes of development are necessary for the welfare of the country, did the government take care to find out in what other matters and to what extent there could be economy in the matter and in the administrative sphere without going into that matter at all? Useful schemes of development have been held up simply because they did not care or did not want to bring about economy in other fields. So I say the wrong end has been chosen, and even now no assurance has been given to us that economy will be affected in the administrative field in the near future during the next year. We have got to see that the government tackles this problem of inflation properly. I wish to mention one other factor with regard to this fight against inflation. It is stated over and over again that it is a matter of surplus spending power in the hands of the people, which is the cause of all this inflation and rise in prices. I have gone to the rural parts in my state and I can say that the surplus amount of money in the hands of the people is restricted only to a very few people. But the vast majority of the people in the urban areas and also the poor people in the urban areas are, as before, it is not a question of their having any surplus money in their hands. Even now, they are unable to purchase their daily rations, their weekly rations, and they have to borrow even for that sometimes. Efforts met, however, with no success, and on the 5th February 1954, the bank, finding that there was no prospect of further discussions proving fruitful, presented a proposal to the working party, which in its view would produce a fair and economic result for both countries. The government of India gave detailed and anxious consideration to this proposal, which will far short of India's requirements and which in addition involved for them a considerable financial liability, the justification for which was not clear. They decided, however, to accept the bank's proposal primarily because they wished, in the interest of good relations with their neighbor, to take every opportunity that might present itself for the settlement of a dispute which had been in existence for many years. They accordingly communicated to the bank their acceptance of the proposal on March 22, 1954. From 5th of February till the middle of June 1954, the Indian delegation waited in Washington in the hope of getting a clear answer from Pakistan as to whether they did or did not accept the bank proposal. When even in spite of an appeal by the bank, there was no positive response from Pakistan, the government of India had no option but to come to the conclusion that further progress of the cooperative effort undertaken with the assistance of the bank had become impossible, and Pakistan has therefore voided the understanding under which the working party had been set up. Start the various points of view that were expressed then in Parliament would be taken into account by the government and by the people, and serious attempts would be made to see that some solution could be found. The bill that is before us is really an admission of our failure to solve the problem of official language. It is true that this bill does give a new life to English as the official language, and that too for an indefinite period. Why had we to do this when there was a general desire on the part of the constitution makers that on the 26th January 1965, Hindi shall be the official language? It was the wish of the constitution makers that on the 26th January 1965, Hindi should be the official language and that wish of the constitution makers has not been fulfilled because of the fact that we are not able to make full use of the 15 years that were available to us in order to find out an acceptable solution to the problem of the official language. According to the prosecution story, there is no evidence as to how the incident started. When both these persons, PW1 and PW2, reached there, they found that the occurrence was going on. When we examined the fair facts of this case, at the touchstone of the above mentioned principle of law, then the natural conclusion is that the instant case falls within the purview of section 304 part 2 of IPC. There was no previous enmity between the deceased and the accused appellants. The offense must have taken place on the spur of moment. The deceased and the accused persons were laborers on the same ARA machine, as stated by DW1. In the facts of this case, a small wooden piece was used as a weapon of offense. It also reflects that there was no intention to kill. An offense took place on the spur of moment. Whatever object came in their hand, they used the same as weapon of assault. They had no deadly weapon. They are two accused persons and only two injuries were found on the body of the deceased, which established that no effort was made to repeat the blow. There was no underlying fracture which reflects that the blow was not given with such force, which could have resulted in the fracture of the underlying skull bone. It is true that doctor has opined that injuries were sufficient in the ordinary course of nature to cause death, but this opinion of the doctor has been given, keeping in view the factual internal damage caused by the injury, and not keeping in view the nature of actual external injury caused by the deceased, which was only a lacerated wound. Every lacerated wound on the head cannot be any stretch of imagination be said to be sufficient in the ordinary course of nature to cause death. That too when it has not been caused by any deadly weapon. Third, there is thus no complete bar making an unwasted document admissible in evidence, but for limited purpose it cannot be received in evidence. Section 49 lays down a rule of substantive law, but proviso comprises a rule of evidence. All it permits is that in the contingency contemplated in proviso to section 49, an unregistered document effecting immovable property may be given in evidence. The object is that document which has not conveyed or past title may be used as evidence on the terms where a document remains unregistered and title does not pass the agreement between the party which preceding. Ineffective document still remains. In other aspects, suit for specific performance would be regulated by specific relief act and proviso only as a rule of evidence states as to what document can be received in evidence and to the extent and purpose thereof. In other words, proviso lays down that despite prohibition contained in section, an unregistered document can be received in evidence in certain cases. It cannot be doubted. The rule of evidence cannot enlarge or alter the provision of substantive law. It cannot confer rights if there are none under substantive law. What thus follows in from section on proviso is that, for example, in respect of a zoom for specific province, if it is maintainable at law, otherwise then in such suit an unrecognized document can be received in evidence. Para. Looking into the exposition of law discussed above, it cannot be doubted that an unregistered gift deed may not be admissible in evidence to affect property in dispute, but for collateral purposes the document may be admissible in evidence. The document may be admissible in evidence on the facts stated therein, admitting that property in dispute was owned and belonged to Sri Makhan would be a fact for which such document can be said to be admissible in evidence and has rightly been so applied by the court below. The question number one, therefore, is returned against appellant. In view of the above discussion, it cannot be said that courts below have decided the suit merely on weakness of defense but on the basis of evidence supporting claim of plaintiff and preponderance of probability found in favor of the plaintiff. Notwithstanding anything contained in the following provisions of this act or in any other law, for time being in force, where a magistrate is satisfied that a divorced woman has not remarried and is not able to maintain herself after the Idadak period, he may make an order directing such of her relatives as would be entitled to inherit her property on her death according to Muslim law to pay such reasonable and fair maintenance to her as he may determine fit and proper, having regard to the needs of the divorced woman, the standard of life enjoyed by her during her marriage, and the means of such relatives and such maintenance shall be payable by such relatives in the proportions in which they would inherit her property and at such periods as he may specify in his order, provided that where such divorced women have children, the magistrate shall order only such children to pay maintenance to her, and in the event of any such children being unable to pay such maintenance, the magistrate shall order the parents of such divorced women to pay maintenance to her, provided further that if any of the parents is unable to pay his or her share of the maintenance ordered by the magistrate on the ground of his or her not having the means to pay the same, the magistrate may, on proof of such inability being furnished to him, order that the share of such relatives in the maintenance ordered by him be paid by such of the other relatives as may appear to the magistrate to have the means of paying the same in such proportions as the magistrate may think fit to order. Where a divorced woman is unable to maintain herself and she has no relatives as mentioned in subsection 1, or such relatives or any of them have not been enough means to pay the maintenance ordered by the magistrate, or the other relatives have not the means to pay the shares of those relatives whose shares have been ordered by the magistrate to be paid by such other relatives under second proviso to subsection 1, the magistrate may, by order, direct the State Wakf Board established under section 9 of the Wakf Act 1954 or under any other law, for the time being in force in a state functioning in the area in which the woman resides, to pay such maintenance as determined by him under subsection 1 or as the case may be, to pay the shares of such of the relatives who are unable to pay at such periods as he may specify in his order, doctor advised to take him to the medical college, and then the injured was taken there. Thus, we find that claimant number one has failed to involve bus number UTX5639 in the instant accident. The respondent, in his written statement, in very clear terms, alleged enmity with the claimant on account of Gram Pradhan election, stating that he had defeated Sada Prasad Tiwari in the years 1982 and 1988. However, claimant number one, in his examination in chief, had not at all denied this fact. In the opening of his cross-examination, he has admitted that he fought election of Gram Pradhan against the respondent in the years 1982 and 1988 and was defeated twice. It is pertinent to note here that the respondent has reiterated this election enmity in his examination in chief, which has not been contradicted on behalf of claimant number one in his cross-examination. Thus, it is proved that there was enmity between claimant number one and the respondent, so it cannot be denied that his bus has been falsely implicated in the instant accident. Now we take up statement of alleged eyewitness of the incident, Sitaram PW2, his examination in chief is reproduced as under par. The above statement of the sole eyewitness does not at all prove the rash and negligent driving of the opposite bus by driver of the respondent. Cross-examination conducted on behalf of the respondent from this witness shows that he had tried to hide his intimacy with claimant number one. He has denied the suggestion that claimant number one is his maternal brother or relative. Even he has stated that claimant number one does not belong to his caste, but he had to admit in the next breath that he and claimant are Brahmins. He has claimed that his house is situated near the place of accident, but this statement does not find corroboration from the site plan. Our judgment will raise a legitimate query. If the appellant was not present in his house or the material time, why then did so many people conspire to involve him falsely? The answer to such questions is not always easy to give in criminal cases. Different motives operate on the minds of different persons in the making of unfounded accusations. Besides, human nature is too willing, when faced with brutal crimes, to spin stories out of strong suspicions. In the instant case, the dead body of a tender girl, raped and throttled, was found in the appellant's house, and instinctively everyone drew the inference that the appellant must have committed the crime. No one would pause to consider why the appellant would throw the dead body in his own house. Why would he continue to sleep a few feet away from it? And whether his house was not easily accessible to all and sundry, as told by the resourceful Ram Sharma, no one would even dare to consider why the appellant's name was not mentioned to the police until quite late. These are questions for the court to consider. The Fox of Karajna had a grounds against the appellant. He made a nuisance of himself to his family and friends, neighbors and tenants. The small world of Karanja was up in arms against him. He had assaulted his mother and brother a few days back. The incident, he had a quarrel with Seelabai, his tenant. On the very day of the incident, he was an idler and had no means of livelihood. The description of his clothes at the time of his arrest is an eloquent commentary on the way of his life. He was wearing two full pants, one on top of another, not because he had one too many to wear, but because one of the two pants was torn at awkward places and he had to hide his shame. It was torn on both the hips as well as the center. The left leg of the pant was torn over 2 feet and the right leg over half a foot. The shirt on his person was torn all over. The right arm of the shirt was hanging precariously by the wrist of the torn portion of his shirt. The tenant filed written statement and pleaded that the rate of rent was ₹50 per month, which also included the water tax. He pleaded that tenancy was continuing since 1962. The accommodation in dispute consists of 2 rooms, veranda, angan and bathroom. Tenant stated that he had paid the rent till September 2000 and that rent for October 2000 was sent through money order, which was refused by the landlady. Hence, he deposited the same under Section 30 of UP, Act No. 13 of 1972. He also stated that he had filed a suit for permanent prohibitory injunction, seeking to restrain the landlady from evicting him forcibly. The tenant asserted that rent receipts were never issued by the landlady. Regarding rate of rent, court below held that rate of rent was ₹50 per month as asserted by the tenant. The tenant in his oral statement stated that it was only agreed that rate of rent would be ₹50 per month, which would also include the water tax. The court below under issue number 2 held that in view of Section 7 of the UP Urban Buildings, within bracket regulation of letting, rent and eviction, Act 1972, UP Act No. 13 of 1972, in the absence of any written contract, water tax would be payable apart from the rent. Section 7 starts with words subject to any contract in writing. To the contrary, the tenant shall be liable to pay to the landlord in addition to and as part of the rent the water tax. I do not find any error in the finding of the court below that in view of Section 7, the act, tenant was liable to pay water tax apart from ₹50 per month rent. Accordingly, it was rightly held that tenant was defaulter in not paying water tax, which by virtue of opposite subsection 7 of the act is part of the rent. Yeah.
in state of Punjab versus Ram Singh, which was relied upon by the courts below. In holding that the misconduct stood condoned was explained in Man Singh. No law has been laid down in Bakshish Singh to the effect that only in the event leave without pay is directed to be granted while passing an order of punishment. The leave having been regularized, the order of punishment also becomes bar in law and void ab initio. While deciding Bakshish Singh, this court had not taken into consideration an earlier precedent in state of MP versus Harilal Bhopal, wherein it has clearly been stated that such an order is passed only for the purpose of regularizing the leave and thereby the effect of punishment is not wiped out. In Man Singh, it was held that the period of absence when treated as leave without pay was with a view to regularize the leave and not for non-duration of misconduct. In the light of the aforesaid, the court is of the view that the order of payment of salary was only confined with regard to the length of service, so that the period of unauthorized absence may or may not be included in the length of service. The order granting salary or denying him salary does not amount to a punishment contemplated under Rule 4 of the Rules of 1991. In the instant case, the competent authority passed an order that the petitioner would not be entitled for salary on the principle of no work, no pay. Heard Sri Anupam Kulshrestha from Learned Council for the petitioner and the learned, additional Chief Standing Council for the respondents. For the submission of Sri Anupam Kulshrestha is that the instrument in question was a deed of assignment in respect of an undetermined amount of monetary benefit, which was the subject matter of the reference prepared by Sri Ram Babu under Section 18 of the Act, 1894, and it was not a deed of conveyance of title or interest in the land in question, which had already been acquired by the UP Awas Evam Vikas Parishad in acquisition proceedings culminating in the award dated 26.8.1985 stop. In this view of the matter, Sri Kulshrestha submitted the stamp duty on assignment of rights to the mandatory benefits, stamp duty was chargeable and rightly paid as provided under Article 55 of the Act, 1899, and the deficiency of stamp duty computed by the respondent number 3, treating the instrument to be a deed of conveyance, was based upon a complete misconception of law. Sri Kulshrestha further submitted that the revenue authority also failed to consider the specific objection of the petitioner and has only followed the order passed by the respondent number 3, the A.B.M. open bracket finance and revenue close bracket para. Learned Additional Chief Standing Council also very fairly acknowledged and accepted that the instrument in question was the deed of assignment and not a deed of transfer of title or interest in the property, inasmuch as the land in question had already been acquired by the UP Awas Evam Vikas Parishad, and therefore by the instrument in question, what had been transferred was an assignment of interest of an undetermined future monetary benefit, which was the subject matter of reference under section 18 of the Land Acquisition Act, 1894, preferred by Sri Ram Babu Para. Shri Anupam Purushesh has placed reliance upon the full bench decision of this court, reported in AIR 1979 Allahabad 355, open bracket, Chief Controlling Revenue Authority, Applicant versus Messer NT Biotech Project Vidharbha Rishikesh, close bracket, and particularly referred to observations made by the full bench in paras 9 and 11 of the said judgment. Stop. Paras 9 and 11 of the full bench judgment read as follows, colon paras. Next comes the question whether the instrument could be considered to be a conveyance. Stop. The term conveyance are being defined in section 2 within bracket 10 of the Stamp Act as under colon para. Conveyance includes a conveyance on sale on every instrument by which property, whether movable or immovable, is transferred inter vivos, or which is not otherwise specifically provided for by Schedule 1, Schedule 1-A or Schedule 1-B, as the case may be para. This term denotes an instrument in writing by which some title or interest is transferred from one person to another. Stop. It would appear from this definition that an actual transfer of property is an essential feature of conveyance. Stop. Consequently, an agreement to transfer property in the future cannot be treated as a conveyance para. Emphasis may be laid at this based on the words on sale and is transferred used in the definition of the word conveyance. These words are significant. Stop. They denote that the document itself should create or vest a complete title in the subject matter of the transfer in the vendee. Stop. If therefore, there is no transfer, the requirement of conveyance or sale could not be said to be satisfied. Stop. Appraisal of the various clauses of the instrument would show that no transfer of water took place under it, parties had simply agreed to sell and purchase water in the future para. Even the amount which was payable by the company was not stated in this document. Stop. The quantum of the liability depended on a future contingency. Last is our story from writing.
Having dealt with the non-corporate sector, I now turn my attention to the corporate sector. The tax rates for this sector are not...